Well, I want to thank everyone for coming down here to Mission Memorial. Very historic building, beautiful building, right across from the Mission Houses and Kauai Hau Church. And want to talk about some very important things for the people of the city and county of Honolulu. Number one is we just got off the phone with the governor's office. As you know, we sent our order over on Tuesday to open up into Tier 2 for the city and county of Honolulu. And he says he will be signing the order in the next couple hours and getting it back to us. He's reviewed it. He's had his attorney general review it and others review it. And they're okay with it, and he'll be signing it. So the good news, come midnight tonight, we move into Tier 2. And I guess I'm asking all of us to please do our very best so we remain in Tier 2. That we don't have to go back to Tier 1. It's easy to go back. It's hard to go forward under our framework, reopening framework. It's easy to go back. In the next 2 weeks, if our number of cases go up above 100 for 2 weeks in a row, 7-day average, we go back. So let's go back. I don't want to go back ever again. I want to go forward. And I'd like to actually get down to Tier 3, and I believe we can do it, because he showed each other that we can make a difference by just practicing all the requirements, which are wearing your face covering. I got a new one. Voting. Vote. Please vote. Our lives depend on it, literally, I believe. And of course, being physically distant, 6 feet apart, and avoiding large groups, no more than five. And we can continue. As a result, as you all know, we had 65 cases today. And the average, 7-day average, as of yesterday, was 64 cases and a positivity rate of 2.9. So we're doing great. Now, we're here today to talk about driver's license and renewals, and obtaining duplicate state IDs. As you know, because of the pandemic, we've had to cancel a lot of in-service opportunities, and we've had to close satellite city halls on a number of occasions, which has really created a huge backup. 78,000 appointments have been canceled since the beginning of this pandemic. 78,000 canceled appointments. And on top of it, every single month, up to 10,000 licenses need to be renewed. So it says cha-ching, cha-ching, more coming due in a very difficult time because of the pandemic. And there are not only licenses, things like state ID, learner permits, out-of-state transfers, written test, road test. And we've tried to assist as much as possible with remote services as a way to get the paperwork done. And these are so important because as we open up, we can travel again. We can travel inner island, at least to Maui and Kauai, with a pre-travel test. You can go to the continent and do things. And if you get a pre-travel test before you come back, you don't have to be in quarantine. And you need a license to do that, or a passport, but mainly a license. And so you want to have the ability to do all of these things as we open up again. And so one thing, you know, Sherry Kajiwara, who's right here, is a very awesome director of communities, customer services, has done innovative work from day one when she joined our team 8 years ago, has been doing certain things. She's increased service offerings by adding an hour early and an hour late of every day, so people have more time before work and after work to do their paperwork. They're open on Saturdays, so you can do transactions, and they're hiring more staff to help get things processed. But they're going to be doing other things, and that's why we're holding the press conference today, and Sherry Kajiwara is here to talk about her other initiatives to really help with customer service and help the folks of Oahu get what they need done when they interface with the city and county of Honolulu. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. You know, I love this mask design because it hangs and I never lose it, and it's there when I need it. So I want to let you guys know that Mayor and I have always been focused on our ability to meet the public's needs. And as Mayor said, we were preparing for an increase in driver license renewals in 2020. But now with the pandemic, we had over 78,000 appointments canceled, which just compounded the need. So it was very obvious to us that we needed to look for better ways to serve the public. So as licenses and IDs are state products, we're very glad that the state decided to extend expiration dates. Right now, the state has extended them to November 30. But as counties administer the programs, what Mary and I were concerned about was the traffic jam or the backlog that would be created down the road. So it's obvious that we had to find better ways. So this, what we're announcing today, is a start. We have two ways to meet the need. One is, as Mayor mentioned, increase our service by added hours and added people. The second way is to try to decrease demand for appointments, and that's the effort we're announcing today. So after much consideration, discussion with the state, we are going to allow a lot more transactions to be done by mail-in. So right now, you can get a driver license duplicate online or by mail. If you want a duplicate for the star and you've already brought in your documents, you can also get that by mail. You can now get a CDL duplicate by mail. And this is the new one that is really going to affect a lot of our people trying to apply for programs or those that need medical needs. You can now get a state ID duplicate by mail. You still have to come in to renew or get issued an ID because you have to bring in your documents. But if we have your documents, you can certainly go online, you can certainly do it by mail. And all of these things I'm discussing right now is online at honolulu.gov/CSD. There's a link that will take you through each one of these procedures, who qualifies, what you do, what you fill out, what you send in. So we tried to make that very clear for you. Now, other than duplicate requests, 2-year licenses, 4-year licenses can be renewed online. Because we have your documents since 2014 when documents were required. Those that have a learner's permit and you're looking to renew it for an additional year, you can also do that by mail. In addition, if you have a provisional license and those are licenses our youth get, after you've held it for the required time, you can convert that to a regular license by mail as well. So all these services, Mayor, we're looking at over 25,000 people being able to take care of their transactions by mail. Now that's really important because that's going to open up a lot of appointments for those that require a face-to-face transaction. And I do want to point out that right now we're suffering from a 20 to 25% no-show rate. That's a lot of unused appointments that are going wasted. So my messaging is, if you don't need your appointment, please cancel it so that it can be available to the next person. So we try to make these new procedures as easy as possible for everyone. But the one component that we are retaining is the need for vision clearance. It's a simple matter of safety out on our public roadways. So we reached out to the Hawaii Optometry Association and asked, how can we make this as easy as possible for the public? So we have representatives here that we're asking to share their hints and ideas on how you can best meet this need. Because if you are going to be mailing in, you need to put this certificate in the envelope so that we can process you. In addition, if you are walking in, if you bring that certificate with you, you can skip the eye test on site. That's a lot less stress for you, and it's a lot quicker processing for us. And again, efficiency is what we're after. So I'd like to introduce Dr. Linda Arakaki from the association to share a few words.
Thank you, Mayor Caldwell, and thank you, Director Kajiwara. We commend the City and County of Honolulu for seeking alternate ways to meet the licensing needs of our residents during this unprecedented health crisis. When it comes to safely driving on public roadways, maintaining proper vision is key. The focus should always be on public safety. State law requires vision clearance when renewing a license. And the Hawaii Optometric Association and the Hawaii Ophthalmological Society encourages you to take advantage of these mail-in options. To assist you, we offer these helpful hints. If you have visited your eye care doctor within the past 6 months, reach out to that doctor and ask them to provide you a completed driver's vision certificate. This is an example of what one can look like. It's a small form that contains visual information required for the vision certificate. If your doctor has their own form, you may use that for the driver's license, for the driver's vision certificate. You will need to submit this with your renewal application. State law requires that it be current within 6 months. If you have an appointment scheduled with your eye care doctor, please ask them for a certificate, and it can be provided to you at the end of the exam. Thank you.
Before we open to questions, I don't know if Charlotte Nakota wants to say a few words. You've been involved with this association for years. Maybe you can just do some closing comments about our program. Thank you. Charlotte Nakota.
Thank you. We've actually been doing this, giving the vision certificates for many years, and I actually had to do my last year in 2019, brought that, and DMV was really grateful. They don't have to have somebody clean the machine. It's fast, it's convenient, and every doctor on this island should be able to do it. And the Hawaii Ophthalmological Society is all in with us, and they are more than willing to help you out. So don't forget, do it. It's easy, and everybody should be able to get a copy of one of them. If it's not this one, like I said, a lot of them have them online. You can do it.
Thank you, Charlotte. Perfect. Okay, we'll open up to any questions regarding this new program and initiatives for Sherry and the doctor. And then if there's other things you want to ask about COVID related, I'll stay around as long as you have questions. Is that okay to go first with that, this stuff? Okay.
Yeah. I'm gonna ask about the DMV and so forth first. Yeah. I know that the state has extended the deadline until November 30th, but what about on the federal level for people who still have to use their ID for travel? Does TSA also recognize that particular deadline, for travelers?
I do understand that TSA is accepting expired licenses for the time being. I think we would just probably have to watch the TSA's website to know what dates they're extending to. But I understand November 30th is Hawaii's extension date.
So same for state IDs as well?
Yes, all credentials.
Director Kajiwara, Gordon Pang at the Star Advertiser wants to know why the city was not able to allow license renewals earlier.
Well, we have always been allowed to renew licenses. That is part of the law. But the renewal by mail is a process that was developed for out-of-state residents. And we were always able to apply that. But what we were seeking is a way to offer reduced requirements. For example, the current law requires that you get an affidavit that you don't have a license issued in another jurisdiction. Obviously, that was for out of state. It also required you to get a physical and submit that with a mail-in renewal. But what we found with many of our people is that doctors aren't accepting non-urgent appointments. So many people were having difficulty meeting that. So we've had some discussions with the state. We tried to be sure that we met the letter of the law, and this is what we came up with. No physicals required, no affidavit is required, but vision is something that we feel should be required.
Gordon also wants to know, not everyone has an ophthalmologist or optometrist. Are they precluded from mailing in?
They will be required to include vision clearance to use the mail-in process. So if they don't have a doctor, Dr. Akaki, is there any other option that they can use?
We encourage these applicants who do not currently have any eye care doctor to either go online, look at their insurance listing, and choose one. Eye care is a very important thing to be done, and having good visual health for driving is of utmost importance.
I want to add that I've even had people tell me that they've gone to Costco, Sam's Club, Walmart, Walgreens, and they've gotten their vision clearance through those. Those are ophthalmologists. So those are options as well.
Director is from Manolo Morales. What safety measures are in place to prevent ID theft with this renewal mail-in?
All right, for ID theft, we will only mail in We will only mail the credential to the address that's on file. We will not allow any address change. We won't allow any name change. No changes are allowed in this mail-in process. So again, if you have your address on file, that is the only address we will mail to.
Mayor, this has to do with COVID and quarantining and so forth. One of them is, we've talked with several visitors who've had to quarantine because their test results from trusted partners were lost somehow. What is your advice on what those visitors should do when they aren't able to leave the hotel for a second test?
So one, they got to comply with the state laws that are in place. And as you know, Governor Ige has allowed visitors to be exempted from quarantine if they get a trusted partner pre-test. If you don't have such a test, or it's not from a trusted partner, or you didn't get your result back because it was lost or something, then unfortunately, and it's very unfortunate, you're going to have to be quarantined for 14 days. Now, we've been in discussions with the state to see if perhaps there could be a post-test permitted. And we have a mobile lab out at the airport right now that's being ramped up. They could do up to 10,000 tests a day. It's a PCR test. It's a gold standard. And if we can get this lab up and running, initially it would be used for inter-island travel where you get a pre-test. And if we see it's working well, we're going to suggest that perhaps those who come in with a not trusted partner test or a result got lost or whatever, they could get a second test and get out of quarantine. And we'll be asking that of the governor, but we're not ready right now because we don't have our lab up and running yet.
Do you think it's going to be more difficult maybe to move forward into tier three, considering that we do have a lot of visitors coming in as tourism has reopened? And I saw a lot of HPD the other night who were out patrolling in on Kalakaua Avenue, and I wondered at first what's going on. Then I realized they're out trying to enforce. How difficult will it be, you know, to hold on to that 2-week period or, you know, that period before we can move into tier three?
I think the answer depends on the behavior of the residents of the city and county of Honolulu and our visitors, by the way. If we do everything that's required of us, I believe we can actually get to tier three and even down to tier four. I mean, you see in countries like New Zealand or South Korea, even a huge country like Japan, people, through their following all the protocols, can actually manage the number of cases and really lower it. So that's my hope and that result rests in our hands, in our visitors' hands. And we got to make sure that everyone knows what those requirements are, starting with our visitors now who are arriving and need more education than receiving.
And one more, and that has to do actually with the bars. A lawsuit filed yesterday. I don't know if the administration was able to comment on that yet. I know usual practice is not to comment on a pending lawsuit, but any comment on?
Well, you know what the answer is going to be. I can't comment on any pending lawsuit. Once the lawsuit is completed, I'd be more than happy to answer those questions.
And I think one more, and that is, you mentioned yesterday that you were meeting with the hotel managers today to discuss ways to educate tourists and visitors. Have you done that?
That's happening this afternoon. We're meeting with the Hawaii Tourism Authority and the new executive director, John DeFries. He's inviting others to participate in that conversation. This morning, we also had a meeting put together by the chief of police, Susan Ballard, and her deputy, John McCarthy, along with the security element of our major hotels. They're in internal police, basically, to talk about how do we do a better job of, one, making sure quarantine is enforced for those who are in quarantine, and about, you know, rough average, about 75% of the people coming to Oahu have a pretest, they're exempt, but that does mean 25% aren't. We have probably more than 10,000 people in quarantine right now. Hard to enforce just having the police do it. And so the good news is the hotel security guys are stepping it up, and they're calling up to rooms to make sure people are there 3 times a day, and if they don't answer the phone, they're calling the room phone, not their cell phone, they're knocking on the door. That was really good to hear. So we have a good partner, I believe, with these major hotel chains. The smaller ones, they don't sometimes have security. Now we're going to talk with John DeFries. I think it's going to result in even better education efforts and, you know, make sure that we can move to tier three.
Tomorrow.
Oh, excuse me. So I'm projecting. I wish it was today. And I think we're aiming for today, but I guess Thursday. Is that okay? Okay.
This next question is from Sarah Madison, KHON2. If you can explain how you were trying to get information and numbers from the state's surveillance testing program.
You know, this, when Oahu agreed to their pre-travel testing program, one of the assurances we were provided that there would be a surveillance test provided where 10% of all arrivals would get a second follow-up test 4 days after arrival. So 3 days before they left, 4 days after, 7 days, that's like the magic window to find out if people are shedding or not. And that's our insurance policy for the city and county of Honolulu to make sure we're not encouraging or taking on more risk than we should. And I don't care really, we don't care who's doing the surveillance testing program. We just want to know it's being done and that we start getting the results. We thought we'd start testing on Thursday, the first day of arrival. We'd have our results by Monday yesterday, or 2 days ago. We don't have those results yet, and we're anxious to find out what is out there. Is it showing that very few people are getting through that are positive, that they already had a negative pretest?
Sarah, a follow-up, wants to know what you think of the Lieutenant Governor's response that the surveillance test is part of a study and proper data will take time to analyze.
Well, again, we look for information. We have taken on risk opening up the visitors, and we need to know what the results are of those risks. And finding it out after the fact does not protect the people of Oahu who are concerned about opening up the visitors. You read about it, you hear about it. And we expected to start seeing results quickly to find out what's out there. But we don't know what's out there. And we're hoping we'll get those answers quickly so we can take appropriate action if necessary.
Another one from KHON, this is from Manolo. With so many states surging with cases, what do you think should be done to make sure we keep our cases down?
So, you know, that relates back to the, you know, the surveillance testing. As you know, our prevalence is dropping and dropping and dropping. We're keeping our cases down. If Oahu was a state, we'd be ranking at the very bottom of in terms of states with the lowest prevalence. And we have visitors come from places where we're seeing an increased number of cases. That's the very risk we're talking about that surveillance testing will tell us about. And knowing what the risk is 2 or 3 months from now doesn't help us. We need to know in real time so we can take appropriate action to keep our prevalence lower. And it could include, for example, doing a second test. You know, some of the other counties have talked about that. We elected not to based on the fact we'd be getting results from surveillance tests showing what's out there. So maybe we're gonna have to look at doing a second test. Voluntary, maybe mandatory if we see the number of cases going up. But for us, each of us on this island, the residents, we gotta be very careful because we could have a repeat of what we had back in August if we aren't.
Several reporters are asking for clarification again on the update of our signed order. Where is it now? When do you expect it?
So it went over to the governor yesterday morning. It's been reviewed by his attorney general. We placed a call to the governor's office right before this press conference. I hope I would have it to share with you signed. But the governor assured us he is going to be signing it in the next couple hours. And upon his signature, we'll be posting it to our website. But as far as we know, there's no changes. We did post the draft yesterday. And I would be almost certain that that's how it's going to look when he signs it.
Quick clarification there. 10,000 people in quarantine right now on Oahu?
I'm saying it's probably even more than that. I'm rounding down probably for everyone coming in. These are both visitors and residents, right? Any visitor returning resident without a pretest has to quarantine for 14 days.
So just for this time?
Yes. And it'll grow every day, right? More visitors are coming. It's a 14-day quarantine period, so some are gonna fall out, but right now it's adding up more and more every day. It's going to be in the 20,000 number shortly, I would say.
And you say at this point, at least as far as residents, that it might be harder to enforce, even though you are working with the hotel industry, et cetera, to try to keep up with that.
But my hope is, if you're a returning resident, you know, there is kuleana, right? We all feel kuleana to our family, to our neighborhood, to our workers, and to the broader community. And I would hope that most returning residents are in a quarantine for the 14-day period, because they know how important it is to protect their loved ones and everyone else.
Anyone else? That's it, Mayor.
Okay. Well, I want to thank everyone. And again, you know, tomorrow we'll be in Tier 2. And let's stay in Tier 2. It's easy to move back. Could go back in 2 weeks if we don't practice all the right behaviors and protocols. And we can go forward into Tier 3. I'd like to return to, down to go to Tier 3. We're coming into Halloween next week. You know, there's this great ad in midweek, and it'll be in the Star Advertiser this Sunday, of a pumpkin wearing a mask. It says a different kind of mask this Halloween. The message is to our keiki, but it's a message to all of us, from our adults who may want to go to Halloween parties to our kids who want to trick or treat. This is a different type of Halloween. It doesn't mean we don't celebrate, but it's how we celebrate in a very different way, so that perhaps the Halloween next year will be like it was before. And that can happen if we do our part. So my request is, as we go into this first holiday period before Thanksgiving and then Christmas and New Year's, we act differently. We may celebrate the same holiday, but in a very different way. Thank you.